Hi there. In this tutorial, I'm going to mostly talk about how to control the movement of something like these robot arms using something called inverse kinematics. So we'll start by just making ourselves a very basic armature. So an armature is constructed of something called bones, and an armature is called an armature because that's what's used when a physical animator wants to move, for example, a human-like character around. He'll have something inside it, usually made of wire and perhaps joints, that allows him to move those limbs and so on around a small amount between each frame. So an armature effectively does the same thing, whether it's in real life or in an animation program like Blender. So we'll first of all add, and we'll come down to armature, and we'll just say single bone, and there it is. That's called a bone. It literally works like a bone. We'll now go into edit mode, and automatically the top ball there is selected. And we can do what I'm about to do in several different ways, but this one of the simple ways is just to press E and then return and then GZ, and we can just drag that up. And then we'll press E, return again, and GZ, and drag it up again. So we've got three bones here. And because of the way we created them, they are all joined together. So if I select the whole bone, press G and try and move it around, you can see that middle bone moves around with it. Now that's not kinematics as such, it's just maintaining a join between those bones. What we really want is that when that bone moves around, the whole body, as it were, accommodates that movement by trying to point at it. Now armatures have several different mechanisms for moving them. So here we're in edit mode. So I can set, if you like, the base position of this armature, the rest position, if you like, and then everything else I do will be from that point. And for this very simple shape, we'll go with that at the moment. If you were creating a human, you'd normally put it into some kind of T shape. So if we now go to pose mode, you can see the one I've got selected has got a sort of blue outline to it. I press G now and move it, you notice it's not going anywhere. All that's actually happening is it's rotating because its movement is currently restrained by the one below it. It has to stay connected, and in pose mode we're not stretching it or distorting any of the bones. So the only thing it can do to try to get as close as it can to where I want it to go is rotate at the moment. So the next thing I'm going to do is come down here. Now you notice we've got a little bone shape there, that's the bone properties. And below that we've got this, which is bone constraints, and I'm going to add a bone constraint. I'm adding inverse kinematics, and you can see it's changed color and we've got IK there. So I'll just try and move it now, and you can already see it's moving in a much more natural way. So as I stretch it, the whole shape will straighten out to be as close to where I'm trying to drag it as it can be and just point in that direction. If I bring my mouse down close to the base, it crinkles up. But even now, nothing's distorting. Your bones generally don't stretch and shrink, though there are something called bendy bones in Blender. We're not going to do those for this application. But you can see immediately it's doing some useful things. So a little bit about this. If I set the chain length to 1 and now move that around, you can see it goes back to how it was. If I set it to 2, you can now see the next bone in is moving, and you may just be able to make out that there's a yellow line that's showing how far the tail, as it were, of this bone is going. So if I wanted this area to stay completely static, at least in relation to what this bone is doing, I would, in this case, I would have a chain length of 2. And if I put the chain length to 3, we're back to where we were. So 0 is basically infinite. It'll go all the way to the root bone, and the root bone is the first one you created. And in this case, because there are only 3 bones, 3 does exactly the same thing. So if I were to create another bone in here, that perhaps by subdividing this one, that would stop at the base of this one because we'd have 1, 2, and 3, and then this one would stay where it is. But again, for my application, I want this to work in this way. If I don't want a base that moves, then I don't necessarily even need a bone there, depending on what I'm trying to achieve. So 0 or 3 in my application is fine. And we've already got something that works. So the next thing I'm going to do is just apply some mesh around this so that we've got something to animate, because this won't actually be visible in the rendered view. And I'm just going to switch to Eevee because that's a quicker way to do these sorts of things. Now my cursor is still down there at the base of my bones. So I'm just going to add a mesh, which is a cylinder. We'll go to wireframe, we'll move that up and then scale it down. And we'll scale on everything except for Z. And in fact, I think I'm going to move that down to here because this is going to be the base. I'm going to create something somewhat similar to the shape I did before. So this isn't really about modeling, but I'm just going to quickly model something similar to what I did before. And I'm in edit mode and I'm going to add some more shapes. So I'll add another cylinder somewhere around there. I'm just keeping it within the pivot point. And then I'm going to just add an icosphere. We'll put several subdivisions on it so it's nice and smooth. And I'm using that really just to contain the end of these cylinders. So I'll just put some simple materials on them and we'll also add a subdivision surface. We'll set it to smooth shading. Okay, I just had to quickly delete the faces of those cylinders so that it worked better. So that's our basic robot arm. But you can see we can't really see the armature inside at the moment. And also they're not connected together. If I move that armature around, you can see it doesn't have any connection. With the armature selected, we'll just go to the object properties under visibility. We'll make sure it doesn't show up in the render. And under viewport display in object properties, we'll select in front. This used to be called X-ray. So now, no matter where we look, we can see our armature effectively in front of any object we've got in the scene. Can be a bit confusing sometimes, but that's handy when we want to control the armature. So let's connect these things together now. We select our mesh, then hold shift and select our armature, control P, and we set parent to armature deform with automatic weights we'll select for now. You can do empty ones or envelope ones. We'll go with automatic weights and see how that does. Quick way to see how that worked. We go to object mode, make sure the armature is selected. We'll go to object mode and change that to pose mode. We've already got our top bone selected, press G and move it around. And you can see, because I created it sort of from separate mesh objects, albeit it's all one mesh, that's actually set up the influence quite well. I don't actually see any problem there. Now it's perfectly possible that there would be a problem. So if I go to the mesh, come out of pose mode, go to object mode, we'll select the mesh as well, and then we'll go to weight paint. Now what happens is that depending on which bone is selected will show us the weight, as it were, of selection. So you can see this top bone has a small influence on the sphere, but it's all red for that top object, which means it's fully selected. Because that's a sphere and it's not showing any distortion, I'm not overly worried about it. So if I go to vertex groups, you can see it's created three vertex groups. I didn't name my bones. If I had, those names would be reflected in here. But what I can do is select each of those vertex groups that are named after the bones in turn, and you can see what part of the mesh is selected. So you can see that top one, it's fully selected the sphere, but hasn't had any influence over here. So that means that bone there will have no influence over this base, but maximum influence over here. That middle bone will have full influence over the central point and some influence over either end and so on. So if that isn't quite right, let's say for this middle bone, I wanted to have some influence over this sphere, we can increase or alter the weight here. So you can see we can change the amount of influence there. We can also do that another way. So if I go to edit mode, and this is probably the way you want to do it for some shapes like this, we'll select a face on that sphere and we'll select a face on that cylinder. Control L, that has now selected all the faces on those two parts of the mesh because they were separate parts. So Control L, it's just selected all the linked parts. And then I can just click assign. Come out of edit mode, you can now see we've got red there, so they're fully selected. And then I can come up to here, go to edit mode, do the same thing again, Control L and assign. And now that one's fully selected. As it happened, it was working fine. Though there's something slightly weird. I must have left this bottom one selected. So I need to remove the selection here, because if I move that bone around now, you can see it's not quite right. The reason is because I actually got my bones mixed up. That's obviously the third bone. So I need to go into edit mode, assign that one, and then select all these vertices down here and say remove. So there's the top bone, there's the next bone, there's the third bone. That bottom bone has obviously got some faces up the top there selected that shouldn't be. So I can now go into edit mode, Control L, and remove. And now they make sense. If you want to, you can rearrange them to sort of match the shape. And of course, this is where naming the bones comes into its own, because it then is a bit more sensible as to what's going on. So if we move that around now, you can see we're back to where we were. Everything's fine. And the odds are, if you construct a shape like this, unless it's very complex or you've got lots of little arms coming out, as it were, that run quite close to each other, the automatic weights will probably work quite well. So then in terms of controlling it, you can just animate this shape. So if this is really just making a little dancing arm, then you can just record a pose. So you can place it there, press I, and you can select whatever element you want. So you can say whole character or just the selected bone, for example. Go to somewhere else in the animation, perhaps here. Move that somewhere else altogether, press I, and again, selected bone. And you can see it's just recorded the relative change of that bone. So if you want to just animate very basically, we can press I and select whole character, go to somewhere else in the time frame, move our robot arm around somewhere else, press I and whole character again. And now when we press play, you can see it animates nicely. And all I've done is recorded the movement of that one element. However, that can make it a little tricky sometimes if you really want to get good control over the way that it moves. So what we often do is we'll add a target. Frequently we'll use an actual bone as a target, but you can just as easily use something like an empty. Empties are just shapes that don't render. We use them as controls for other things. So for example, I could add a simple cone here. I'll make it much smaller. I'm going to put it somewhere relevant to the bone. Doesn't matter too much because we can correct things. So this is now our object that we're going to use, and we're going to call that arm target. So right now that has no influence on anything. It's just sat there. I'm going to go back to my bones and I'm going to go to my bone constraints, and you can see I've still got my inverse kinematics here. If I go to pose mode, I can select that, make sure I've got that specific bone selected, and I can now select target. And I'm going to select my arm target. And it's moved slightly because there's always a slight offset on things like that. Currently, it's just picking up the position. So let's see what happens. If I come out of pose mode, let's go back to object mode, grab my arm target here and move that around. And you can see my robot arm is now trying to stay close to that target. And of course, that could be grouped with other things and so on. So I can now animate the position of that in order to control what my arm is doing without needing to do anything with the bones, like go into pose mode, for example. You notice rotation isn't doing anything. If I turn on rotation, now it will try to keep that bone pointed in the same direction as my target. So now I've got quite a lot of control over that robot arm just by moving this one thing. So effectively what I'm doing is I'm saying, to start with, perhaps I'm going to record the location and rotation of my target object here. Then I'm going to perhaps come out to frame 50. I'm going to move my target object here and rotate it to there and press location and rotation again. So now when I press play, you can see my robot arm adjusts itself in a very logical way, because it's using inverse kinematics. Kinematics is, I believe, the study of movement and the way bones connect together. So inverse kinematics is effectively, rather than the movement of the various joints controlling the end movement, which is of course what's really happening, what this does is it says, where do you want it to be? And now I'll work out what the rest of the thing would need to do to get there. So that's why it's inverse kinematics. So from there, we perhaps might go up to here and maybe rotate round like that, and perhaps like that as well, location and rotation. So if I press play again now, I'll go come out of all the graphic view. You can see the arm's gone down there and then quickly turned up to there. So that is a really quick and easy way to control the motion of something like this. Obviously, it becomes more complicated when you're dealing with more organic shapes, but this really gives you a nice basic primer in how inverse kinematics work and how you would use an armature to control a simple shape like this. So I hope you found that useful. If you did, let me know, and I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.
So I hope you found that interesting. If you did, let me know. If you enjoy these tutorials, don't forget to click like and subscribe. I also have a Facebook page and a Twitter account, and I now have a Patreon page as well. And I'll provide links to all of those in the description below. So I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.